Hi, I'm Henry Segerman, and this is a thing. It's a sphere that opens up into a kind of claw shape, and then it can lie flat on the table. In fact, it can also close up into a sphere in the other direction. It's supposed to have just 1 degree of freedom. When it rolls up, all of the hinges roll up together. And it's purely mechanical. There are no hidden motors or electronics. So let me tell you how I got here and how deep of an engineering rabbit hole I've fallen into thus far. The relevant ancestor in the evolutionary tree of the claw is this thing, the geared cube net that I made with Sabeta Matsumoto. A net of a polyhedron is a way of cutting along some of the edges so you can open it out to lay flat onto the table. The cross shape is maybe the most well-known net for a cube, but you can also do this zigzag pattern. Then the gears make it a mechanism with only 1 degree of freedom, so when you pick it up, it automatically shows you what it does. It folds up to make a cube. I think you could gear up a cross-shaped geared cube net without too much trouble, but the zigzag pattern is more symmetric, and so it needed fewer parts to design, so that's what we went for. Alright, so the obvious next step was to do a different platonic solid, and for some reason I jumped to the hardest one, the icosahedron, also known as the standard shape for 20-sided dice. Why is this so much harder? Well, first, a longer chain of parts means that errors and slop can accumulate more. Any mechanical system will have some slop, and as you go along a chain of parts, the slop adds up. It's not so bad here with only 6 parts in the chain of squares, but with the 20 triangles of an icosahedron, there are going to be some long chains. But there's a second difference between the cube and the icosahedron that makes the design a lot more complicated. In these mechanisms, each face has a gear that meshes with a gear on its neighbor's neighbor. So if you're this face, your gear meshes with a gear on the face that's 2 steps further along the pattern. And the face that's 1 step further along the pattern acts as the frame that the other 2 faces rotate relative to. That works nicely when you have 3 squares meeting at a corner, but something more complicated happens when you have 4 or more triangles meeting at a corner, which is going to happen for the icosahedron. This triangle needs to have a gear around here that meshes with the gear on this triangle, and this triangle has a gear around here that meshes with the gear on this triangle. And both of those gears and triangles are rotating around the same axis, this hinge between the 2 triangles. So maybe you'd imagine something like this, where there are gears at different distances from the corner, but then what happens is that these 2 bigger gears from this triangle and this triangle entirely cut off the tip of the middle triangle. That's fine with the squares here in the geared cube net. This square in the middle doesn't extend up beyond the 2 gears coming from the sides, no problem. But it wouldn't work with the triangles because this little gear up here is supposed to be rigidly connected to the middle triangle. Well, it could work if the tip of the middle triangle is somehow connected to the rest of the triangle through the axles that the outer triangles rotate around. That line of thinking led to this design. We don't need gears at different distances from the corner, since we don't need the gears to rotate all the way around, just enough to fold up the net to make the icosahedron. So we can have both gears at the same level, same distance from the corner, and one of the gears connects to its triangle with a hollow barrel, through which there's a rod that connects the other gear to its triangle. This was the strategy for the first prototype I made. And, well, you can see that it's pretty floppy, not exactly the paragon of 1 degree of freedom that I was aiming for. But it taught me a lot and started my journey down a deep engineering rabbit hole of trying to get this working better. Huge thanks to my friend Eric Virgo for lots of advice on this. He is a mechanical engineer who left his job working for Apple to pursue mathematics. I'll put a link to his YouTube channel in the description. He's got lots of cool twisty puzzle stuff up there. I managed to break that first prototype by over-tightening a bolt, which leads us to the first thing to try to improve. The nested axles are cool, but one issue with them is that the gear part has to be made separately from the rest of its triangle, and then the 2 connected together. Otherwise, there would be no way to get the gear through the barrel. One of the many annoying things about the real world is that your design not only has to work, but you also have to be able to get the pieces together in the first place. Print-in-place 3D printing is possible, and I've made mechanisms like that before, but you have to leave a pretty big gap between the different parts, which introduces slop in the hinges. That's not a big deal with this floppy, negatively curved surface, but it's a problem for something that's supposed to have only 1 degree of freedom. So I made the parts separately, then bolted them together. I've got this notched design that, if the geometry were perfect, would stop the gear rotating against the triangle. But the real world isn't perfect, and so the gear can move against the triangle. I guess you could try gluing the parts together, but you'd be braver than me to try that here. And there's another issue here anyway. The rod and the barrel of these hinges are 3D printed plastic rubbing against 3D printed plastic, which just cannot give a very precise joint. It would be better to have something like this for the hinge, a long metal rod precisely going through metal bushings. This has much less slop, but it's hard to see how to do that if a gear has to be rigidly attached to its triangle along the rod through the bushings and this whole concentric axles business. Okay, so what do we do? Well, one thing we have going for us is that the gears don't have to rotate all the way around. They just have to rotate enough to close up the icosahedron, from flat to the dihedral angle, which is about 42 degrees. So we can attach each gear to its triangle with a kind of helix that wraps around a shared axle between the triangles. We can then use the rods and bushings to get a really good hinge between the two parts. Of course, we also need to mount the metal parts onto the 3D printed parts, which is yet another possible source of slop. How big a hole do we need to design into the 3D print to hold the bushing or the rod? The only real way to find out is to test. So here are the test prints I got made with lots of holes in very slightly differing diameters. The holes are also in a few different orientations because the orientation of the print can make a big difference to the size of a hole you end up with. Perhaps I should also be gluing the bushings and rods into the 3D print to really lock them in place, but if I did that, I wouldn't be able to disassemble the thing, so I haven't done that. You can also see at this stage of the design that I'm now spiraling the bevel gears. These are spherical involute bevel gears, which in theory perfectly transfer torque at all phases of their motion. But of course the real world isn't perfect, and at some angles the gears might wobble while in others they don't. This happened in the first prototype at the end of the rotation. This gear just runs out of teeth and we don't get a proper contact with the other gear, meaning that the last triangles can flop around. By twisting the spherical involutes around as we move up the gear, we get all phases at once, which hopefully gives good contact no matter what angle the gears are at. We also worried about the 3D printed triangles themselves flexing. The solution to this is to make the triangles as thick as possible for better rigidity. We also hollowed out the triangles to reduce weight, and there's a thin lattice structure inside, which is good enough to get a very rigid result. If I try to flex it, I can't tell if it's the print or my fingers that are squishing. I think it's my fingers. Here's another problem from the first version. The boundary edges of the net can miss each other as you go to close it up. Part of this is from the last triangles flopping around too much, but it also doesn't help that the triangles themselves are so thin here. Again, thickening the triangles up will help. I also added this zigzag pattern on the boundary edges to give a bit of registration as the net closes up. And I also added in geometry in all of the hinges to stop them from over-rotating past where the net should already be rolled up and closed. All this thickening and having single parts for the triangles and gears makes the geometry pretty chunky and complicated. And we haven't talked about that real-world assembly problem yet. People talk about flight paths for the parts as you move them together for assembly. Figuring out these flight paths ended up being a fair chunk of the work. Here's how two of the triangles fit together. These are some even more prototype-y prototypes I printed just to check that the assembly worked. The size of the gears is limited by this part of the motion here, where I have to get two pairs of gears past each other. It would likely reduce slop if I could make the gears even bigger, but I don't see a way to get parts with even bigger gears together. Okay, now we're past that point, we can helix the gears together into position. There's another trick here. When the triangles are twisting into place, the gears cannot be meshing yet. They'd get in each other's way and prevent you from getting into position. So we need space to twist them in, and then a second motion to slide the triangles towards each other, which makes the gears mesh together. We can then slide the rods in from the side through the bushings that we definitely remembered to insert earlier, and that locks the hinges in place. I think there's one more change we made between the first and second prototypes, the choice of net of the icosahedron. I mentioned before two different nets for the cube, the cross and the zigzag. and we went for the zigzag because it was simpler to design. But in terms of reducing slop in the mechanism, you could argue that the cross-shaped net might be better. The zigzag net has all the squares in a single long chain. The cross still has 6 squares, of course, but the longest chain of squares here is only 4. The length of the longest path across the net, also known as the diameter, seems like a reasonable thing to want to minimize. The zigzag has diameter 6, while the cross has diameter 4. For the first icosahedron prototype, I went with this, which is probably the most well-known net for the icosahedron, but it doesn't have the smallest possible diameter. Here's a path with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 triangles. It's pretty clear that there's no longer path going across the net, so the diameter is 12. But there are lots of other options. Apparently there are 43,380 distinct nets for the icosahedron. Here's what we went with for the second prototype, and it has a diameter of only 10. Again, you can check that there's no longer path. And this one is pretty symmetric. I ended up only needing to design 7 different types of triangle part. Here's a question. Can you prove that there is no net for the icosahedron with diameter smaller than 10? Okay, so we have a design, and it works pretty well. It still has a little bit of flex and wobble, but it's nowhere near as snaky as the first prototype was. I've got some plans for how to make it a little more like a 1-degree-of-freedom mechanism, but I'd love to hear in the comments if you have any ideas. Perhaps some other material would be better. Would it be possible to CNC these parts in metal, for example? What else? I keep calling these triangles, but does this look much like a triangle? Maybe not, but the thinking was to get the engineering working as well as possible first, and then go back to look at the aesthetics. One of the things I'm thinking about doing is putting flat triangular panels on one side of the mechanism. They would stop it from rolling up in that direction, but then you'd really see the triangles both when it's flat and when it's rolled up in the other direction. All of these parts would have been difficult to make with a filament-based FFF printer because I need a lot of precision on the gears, and I need that precision in lots of different orientations. So I went for nylon SLS printing instead. Thanks to JLC 3DP for supplying the prints for this project. I've been very happy with the quality of their prints. The floppiness of the first prototype in particular, but also the floppiness of the second, is due to the design and what I'm trying to do, rather than JLC 3DP's printing. All right, that's it. Thanks for watching.